Let me know when my screen is up. I hope it is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, so this session, approximately some 90 minutes to 120 minutes is what we are targeting. So based on our comfort, I mean, it is not a strict mandatory thing that you we have to do it in a specific time. Okay, so we'll be breaking down this session into three parts. Okay, so first we will talk about why data science become popular and associated terminology, some basic terminology, because terminology is very important for us to discuss a topic and also to make sure that everybody is on the same page, so that you shouldn't be like intimidated by the words that I am using. Okay, so you should feel comfortable in the later part of the session, so that we will discuss about some terminology and why data. So for the first thing that we start with, why data science become popular? And what data science can do, and how companies are using. Okay, how companies are using. So here we will discuss about a case study. Okay, so here we'll discuss about a case study. Okay, so fine. Next. Next. And then industry need and how Innomatics is going to help you in meeting the need. Okay, so what currently industry is expecting and how the course at Innomatics is going to help you to scale up yourself. So somebody, I can see now from the introduction. So the main purpose of the introduction is to understand the demographics of our class. Okay, so demographics are class. I can see majority of people are still studying in first year, second year. So that is great that you have this awareness. So back those days, like I mean 4, 5, 6 years back when data science started, very few people know. But now, because of the internet and also the other medium, social networking mediums, so good that even at this young age, okay, so you are aware of this beautiful technology. Okay, so I appreciate that you are interested in this. Okay, so now we'll talk about how the course at Innomatics is going to help you, because we have a wide variety of people over the call. So somebody is studying, completed, already having some work experience. Somebody start planning to shift their career, transform their career. So the requirement for each individual is different. Okay, so we'll talk about these things. These are the fairly. This is how fairly our session is going to be divided. Okay, fine. And try to stop. Feel free to stop and talk about if you have any doubts. Okay, so don't hesitate to ask doubts. Okay, so fine. Okay. Fine. So see, the entire course, okay, so the entire course, what we are going to learn, okay, is revolving around these two areas. Okay, so one is data science and another is the programming language Python. So we will talk about this. Okay, why only Python? Okay, so because there are n number of languages and tools available in the market to implement the data science. Okay, so first to begin with, what is data science? Where it falls in the multiple terminology that you are hearing in the industry. Okay, so you might be hearing about artificial intelligence, data science, machine learning, IoT, robotics, RPA, NLP, computer vision, okay, data mining, analysis, data analysis. Okay, so cloud computing, different, these are the terminologies which picked up lot of fame in the last 5 years. Agree? Okay, so typically so somewhere around you can say that from 2014-15, where there is a lot of interest in the industry, lot of industry experts and the people in the industry started showing interest in these technologies, and it was there because all these technologies were existing even before 2014 also. So last 5 years, so currently we are in 2020. Okay, so you can say from 2015 to 20, so the technologies were existing even before, but these 5 years there was a tremendous demand to the people who know these technologies, and you can see there are n number of startups. Okay, n number of startups were started in India. Okay, not only in India, in the whole world. Okay, so on the entire globe. So this is a lot of artificial intelligence revolution happened in the last 5 years. Okay, so last 5 years. Now across these terminologies, you don't get confused. So in order to understand how these technologies fall under each thing, okay, so we need to, there is a very thin line of difference between these technologies. Okay, and you, as you progress, as you get experienced, as you spend more and more time in this area, you will get a clear cut understanding of these technologies. But even before that, what we will do roughly, in order to understand, clear the confusion, we will try to answer few things. So see here. So primarily, artificial intelligence is the main branch. Artificial intelligence is the main high level branch. Okay, so under this you have multiple branches like machine learning, NLP, computer vision, robotics, IoT, speech analysis, etc. and etc. Okay, so now see here. So primarily, what our course is, so we have multiple offerings. So those who want to learn the we have like ML program, advanced program, where you will be talking about much more advanced techniques. So we have multiple programs. So based on the need of an individual. So the primary step that you should start with is machine learning. Okay, so machine learning, primarily this will have supervised, unsupervised, and the advanced mode is called deep learning. Okay, so few words you might have heard, but try to remember them in a structured way. So that helps you to understand what you are, what branch of artificial intelligence. Okay, so artificial intelligence is a very vast topic. Okay, it is a kind of umbrella of multiple topics. So under this, you are going to specialize in machine learning, NLP, computer vision. Okay, these things. Okay, so these are the two boxes that you are going to learn as part of this course, and where majority of the industry demand. These are having more demand. Okay, so these are like techniques. Techniques in the sense. So in your engineering, you might have heard about. Tell me one thing. So technique is nothing but adding two numbers is a requirement. So this requirement can be accomplished by using a pen and paper, calculator, Excel sheet, or you can write a program. Okay, so this is the requirement and can be accomplished by in n number of ways. Okay, so fine. So these are the other things: robotics, IoT, speech analysis. Okay, so out of our scope, at least in this discussion. Okay, so we will be primarily focusing on ML, NLP, and computer vision, and these are the main categories. Okay, so fine. Now, so this is what you can also called as a data science. Data science is nothing but how the terminology, the science that deals with data. Okay, so it can bring more and more insights out of the data. The art of getting insights from the data is nothing but the data science. Okay, so which may include all these things together, which may include machine learning and data science. Again, it is a subtopic, it is a branch under artificial intelligence, which may talk about machine learning, NLP, computer vision. Okay, so NLP is nothing but text related analysis. So like, now you write a movie review. Okay, you write a movie review in plain English, and whenever you submit, the system will understand, it will read your review, and it will understand whether it is positive review, negative review, or neutral. Okay, now coming to computer vision. Computer vision is everything about images. Okay, so images. Okay, so face recognition. So in many Hollywood movies, you would have seen, so people are identified based on their facial matches. Okay, so that is nothing but based on computer vision. Okay, and the primary one, machine learning, is what where you will see prediction. Okay, so predictive analytics will be taking part, where you will be estimating what would be the sales for next year, what would be the possibility of a customer buying my product or not. So different kinds of things. We will go in deep. Okay, so we will go in deep. Okay, fine. Now here, all these things, whatever that we have spoken about, machine learning, supervised learning, unsupervised, deep learning, NLP, computer vision, all these things are algorithms. These are algorithm based techniques. Okay, so these are algorithm based, which in turn mathematical. There will be some mathematics between each algorithm. And these mathematics algorithm. Okay, and these mathematics algorithms can be implemented by using tools or programming languages. Okay, so programming languages. So there are n number of programming languages that are available. So now what? Okay, so out of this, we have chosen Python. Okay, we have chosen Python. So just like adding two numbers is your requirement, and you can choose pen and paper, calculator, Excel sheet, and writing a programming language. Okay, and adding two numbers can be written in Java, .NET, Python, SQL, any programming language. Okay, so just like that. So what are the major programming languages that are available currently for us is Python, R, and Java. You can use Java for machine learning implementation or data science implementation. Okay, so and you have Julia, and these are languages, top languages, and you have tools like SPSS, SAS, okay, and Weka, Minitab. Yes, you can use .NET also for ML. Okay, you can use .NET also for ML. Okay, so the existing languages. Okay, so these are the languages, and these are the famous tools that are available in the market. Now you can ask, when there are tools available, why we are focusing on the language? Tools are built by companies and they sell it to the customers, and they don't possess all the customizations. Okay, so if you buy a tool, you can only leverage the techniques that are built in the tool. Okay, so you cannot write a customization, but if you have a programming language knowledge, you can build any logic. So that is the flexibility with the programming language. Okay, so you can have a doubt, why only Python, why not these things? Few years back, maybe at least 3-4 years back, R was the leading tool for the implementation of machine learning or data science. Which is best, SQL or NoSQL? We'll talk about that. Okay, we'll talk about that, SQL, NoSQL. Okay, so R. But recently, from last 3-4 years, Python got tremendous development. Okay, tremendous development. Okay, tremendous development in the availability and the support for machine learning. Okay, so there are n number of packages created, and the implementation is very, very easy. When I say very easy, with just 4-5 lines of code, you can implement an algorithm. When I say many capabilities, many packages were developed in Python, so that just with 4-5 lines of code, you can implement a machine learning algorithm. To that level, it become popular, and people started using that more and more, and it become more popular, and it occupied the top place. Okay, it occupied the top place currently in the industry, and it will stay there for in the near future also. So because of the and also the best thing is Python is a free source. R is also a free source. Okay, so but Python, we'll talk about Python separately. Okay, so just to brief what we discussed till now, data science or ML, these are list of algorithms. Okay, algorithms, math based algorithms, and these things, in order to implement these, you need a tool or programming language. Okay, tools are also good, we are not discriminating any tool, but tools lack customization. Programming languages have the flexibility. Okay, so under this, we are primarily targeting Python. Okay, so Python, why? Because the primary competitor initially for Python is R. Why on top of R we are using Python? Because Python is Galaxy J7 Prime. Okay, so can you tell us about .NET and ML? I am a .NET developer. Yes, .NET can be used for machine learning implementation, but the scope of this discussion is related to data science, how to implement data science using Python. So that is our main scope and main focus of this discussion. So we will be talking about Python. But anyway, .NET is much lagging behind Python in the areas of package availability and implementation. Those are the things I am trying to explain. Python was created in 1990, then why it got attention few years back? Yeah, that's why. So see, not only Python was available for a very long time, even these data science machine learning techniques are also available in the form of research papers, algorithms and mathematics solutions. Let me be very clear, not only Python. So yes, you are correct, Python is available from a very long time. R is also available from very long time. Still R is being used in many universities. Okay, but now slowly the shift is happening to Python, and data science techniques are also not created in last 3-4 years. They are existing from a very long time, where statisticians and researchers, they created these algorithms and they published the papers. Okay, so now lately what happened, see, initially, anybody remember why Python in the olden days, Python is being used by web developers and testers or QA and any other Python major applications even before machine learning? Can somebody help me with that? What are the other uses of Python? Okay, fine. So primarily you can, for web development and testing and QA, or GUI development, graphical user interface development. Okay, so these are the things. Okay, so Python is a 360 degree tool. So that means it can cater web development, it can cater application development. Okay, and it can handle QA. And it can handle graphical user interface development also. Okay, fine. How come, then you may ask, how one language is able to perform all these tasks? Because Python contains libraries or packages. Okay, so if you are a Python web developer, you might not be learning the entire Python that is available on the internet. Not necessary. It is not necessary and not mandatory also. So you will be targeting the packages. You will be targeting the packages that are required for web development. Simple theory. If you are a computer science student and in your college you will be having a library. Okay. So do you read the entire, all the books that are available in the library? No. Is my voice too feeble? Are you able to hear me loud and clear?
Yes, you are. You can go ahead.
Yeah. Manish, can you please increase your system volume? Okay, fine. So if you're a computer science student, is it mandatory for you to read each and every book available in the library? No. So consider your college library as Python. Okay, and books as packages available in the Python. Okay, so based on the need, you will go to a particular section, pick up the book, and then you will read, and then that's it, your job done. So in the same way, based on your role that you are working, or you are planning to start working, so whether you want to be a QA developer or a web developer or application developer, or maybe also some backend developers also use Python. Okay, based on the requirement, these people will choose the required packages from the Python. Just like that. Okay, so just like that, coming back to the question somebody asked, when Python was existing from a long back, why it got attention from last few years? Okay, so for that, I need to tell you, Python is a open source. No license required. It is a free tool. It is a free tool. This open source language is developed. So now tell me, who is creating all these packages in Python? Who wrote the syntax for Python? Who wrote the syntax for basic Python? Who created the packages? And who are still creating the packages? Who are still updating the existing packages? Who is supporting that? Okay, so there is a community behind. There is a community of developers. There is a community of developers. Okay, so they are taking care of Python. They develop packages and they release on a month-on-month basis, on a weekly basis, or whenever possible. Okay, so whenever possible. Okay. Google developing the Python. Okay, fine. Sir, please. Okay. Okay, fine. So this community of developers, say 10 developers, 20 developers, some developers, they will be working on the Python code, implementing the new technologies. Okay, implementing the new technologies. Okay, fine. Now what these people did, they read all the research papers available. Okay, when machine learning or data science started gaining boom in somewhere around 2010 or 14, okay, approximately during this area, they started reading the papers that are published. Okay, research paper contains the algorithm, definition, procedure, and how it can be implemented using the mathematics. Okay, so they read these papers. Okay, and they started understanding the logic. When you understanding the logic and you are a good programmer, you can implement that mathematics logic in the programming language. Okay, in the programming language. So then they started. Okay, so then they started developing all the packages for data analysis. Data visualization and machine learning, deep learning. So these are the key areas where they developed the packages and made the job easy for you and me. Okay, so people like you and me who are interested in the machine learning area. So they made our life very easy by developing these packages, and these package development has seen a huge boost during the 20 maybe in last 10 years you can say in last 10 years. So that is the reason, even before Python was existing from a very long time, in last few years it got such a boom and it crossed R in the demand, and now it is in the top place almost with 17% of market share. Okay, fine. So I hope we are clear. Now coming back to our main focus area, see here. Now data science plus Python. Okay, so data science plus Python, this is what we are going to learn as part of our course. Now here, now the first question, what will you get? Okay, so if you are a developer already, or if you know any programming language, even the amount of programming that you are going to learn in your college, even that is also sufficient. Okay, so because here you are not going to become a Python developer, rather you are going to become a data scientist or data analyst. Okay, so these designations might be different. Different companies call people like different ways, but overall the work will be the same. Okay, now what are the things that I need to target in Python? How much Python that I require? So primarily, as I said, you need Python to do data analysis and implement algorithms. Yeah, I'll talk about supervised machine learning. Okay, I'll talk about supervised machine learning. Okay, so primarily, in order to meet these needs, we are going to teach NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib. These are all the library names, the package names that you are going to learn. Okay, Seaborn and Scikit-learn. Okay, so these are the fundamental packages. It is not limited only these five. So it is not that we are going to teach only this and then leave, because there are, these are mandatory packages, and there are some additional packages also which may require, as and when required on need basis, we will be discussing that. Okay, so here, in order to load the data, handle the data, reshape the data, just play with the data, these are the two packages: data handling. These are the two packages for the data handling. And once the data you want to visualize, these are the two packages for data visualization. So data analysis is a combination of data handling and visualization. Okay, so that means this topic. Okay, and then implementation of algorithms. So I have analyzed my data, I have visualized, which is nothing but handling and visualizing the data. Now how to implement the algorithms? So algorithms are implemented using the package called scikit-learn. This scikit-learn package is has developed tremendously in the last 4 or 5 years. Within just a few lines of code, you can build the algorithm, you can evaluate the algorithm, and you can evaluate the performance of the algorithm, and you can see the results also. Okay, so that is why Python has gained a lot of popularity. These are the five fundamental packages that one has to mandatorily learn in order to become a data scientist. So that is what we are targeting mainly, and also our curriculum includes additional packages as well. Okay, and the another main advantage of Python is it is very easy to learn. Very easy to learn, and those who have the basic knowledge of this develop any programming language. Okay, so whether you may be .NET, Java, so what are the primary things that we are going to learn? Variables and strings, functions, and loops and conditional statements. Okay, majority of the basic stuff. And once you are good at this point, and then we will directly jump to the packages one by one. We will start learning this. That's it. These are the primary requirements. So that means you will be learning Python first, which will help you to implement the data science algorithms. Okay, so in order to learn the data science implementation, first you have to learn a programming language. At this point of time, Python is the good option. Okay. Fine. Now, okay. So this is our, so we discussed about what is data science and what is Python. Okay. So now we will talk about a few more techniques. See, what is the skill set that you are going to, irrespective of our course. Okay, this is the thing that you once should develop in order to become a data scientist. You need to be aware of statistics and AI. You need to be aware of programming fundamentals. Okay, and then you need to know data visualization. Okay, so first I'll talk these three. Okay, so statistics and AI, programming fundamentals, where Python Python will help you in implementing those programming fundamentals, and data visualization. Again, Python has the support to this data visualization as well. Okay, and statistics and AI. Okay, so statistics and AI. AI is nothing but a high level term that we used here. That's okay, which is in this AI branch, as we discussed, we will be learning ML, DL, and other NLP. And CV, computer vision. Okay, and computer vision. Okay, so statistics. What amount of statistics again? Okay, so stats again is a very vast concept, and here you will be requiring about probability and other descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. In statistics, you will be learning descriptive statistics and inferential statistics, and also you will be learning probability. Okay, fine. So these three boxes is what included in our curriculum. Everything, whatever that you are seeing here, is divided into multiple modules, multiple chapters, and all these things you will be learning using the Python implementation. Okay, Python implementation. Okay, so now somebody asked about what is supervised learning. Okay, so before we move forward, I'll just try to explain simply. So in machine learning, you have primarily two branches. There are other branches also, primarily supervised and unsupervised. What is supervised? Supervised is nothing but there will be an existing data set. Okay, so there will be an existing data set. Suppose say you will have sales. So otherwise, let me tell you one thing. Crop yield based on fertilizer that you used and rainfall that you received. Suppose in the year one, you recorded the data. In the year two, you recorded the data. In the year three, you recorded the data. Okay. Rainfall in centimeters, 5 centimeters, 6 centimeters, 7 centimeters, fertilizer, 25 kgs, 30 kgs, 40 kgs, and you got the yield 100, 95, 120 tons of yield. Okay. So now in the fourth year, you want to, now you have a forecast of the rain. Okay. So the weather department told that approximately 5.5 centimeters of the rainfall is expected to occur in this particular season, and you have enough cash to purchase up to 50 bags of fertilizer. Okay, so that means you have these inputs with you. You have these inputs and you have the historical data. Based on these inputs, based on the historical data, you want to identify this number. How much yield I can expect? If this is the estimated rainfall and this is the this amount of 50 bags of fertilizer I can afford this season, so based on that, how much yield can be I can expect? Okay, so that means look at this thing. Okay, so see here, by looking at the existing data, okay, by looking at the past data and by taking the inputs, today's inputs, you are predicting this column. This is nothing but supervised, where supervised learning requires some input variables, input data. So rain and fertilizer is input data, and your crop yield is output. So using the input, you are predicting the output. Okay, so this is the nature. And how do you arrive this one? You try to understand the relationship and understand how these input variables and input values and output values are associated, looking at the historical data. By looking at the historical data, you come to a conclusion, and then you try to predict the future value. So that means using the historical data and input values, you predict the output. That is what supervised learning. Whereas unsupervised learning, it will not have any output value. You are not predicting anything. Here, you are not predicting anything. You will just try to categorize the data. Categorize the data. Suppose say, for a baby who is playing, you have given multiple different shapes and colors. So then what you asked the baby to separate all the toys based on color, all the structures. Like you gave some cubes, you gave some triangles, you gave some squares, you gave some rectangles, you gave some spheres. Okay, so now you asked the baby to separate everything based on color. Okay, so when color is your main thing to separate the data or create different clusters. Okay, so create different clusters. Okay, so what the baby will do, irrespective of different shape. So like one group may have suppose this all these objects belongs to blue color, red color, these two green color, correct? So next time what you did, in the second iteration, you asked the baby to separate the, okay, so to separate the objects based on, not based on color, but based on shape. Now, irrespective of the color, what the baby will do? All the triangles one side, all the spheres one side, on all the squares one side. Okay, so here what you are having, the property of the object, object id 1 2 3 4 5 6, and color property, shape property. Okay, color red green blue, and shape triangle, sphere, square, like that. Okay, so you don't know what that object is, but you know the properties. Okay, you know the color property, you know the shape property. Based on this, okay, you will segregate the data. Okay, so the best example for this one is, you don't know the, many of you might be receiving, or your friends might be receiving calls from the customer care, bank customer care, saying that you are our valuable customer, we are offering personal loan, we are offering a special credit card for you. Okay, so you might receive that call, but your friend might not receive that call. Okay, so why you received that call but not your friend? That is because the banks does not know personally what is your character, nothing. They don't know anything about you personally. Okay, personally the bank doesn't know anything, but what they have, they will have your mobile number. Okay, so they will have your mobile number, and they will have your maybe salary information, and they will have your CIBIL score, how good you are repaying your debts. So if you have taken any personal loan, whether you are repaying correctly or not, whether you are repaying your credit card due amounts correctly or not. So that means financial health score, salary, and city you are living in. Okay, so based on this, they will try to categorize the data. Okay, so they will try to categorize the data into how many ways? So suppose say high income, high CIBIL score. Low income, low CIBIL score. High income, low CIBIL score. Low income, high CIBIL score. Like this. Okay, so here a bank always targets this section, high income and high CIBIL score, because their credit health is good, their income is good. Okay, and also, okay, for these kind of people, they will keep on calling. So based on, so they don't know anything. See here, they are offering a personal loan. Okay, they are offering a personal loan, and they have a database of 1 lakh customers. 1 lakh customers, and they divided these customers into these four groups. Okay, 10,000 people into this, 50,000 people into this, and 20K into this, and 20K into this. Okay, so simple. I am talking about a very simple level. This you can do it even in Excel sheet. Okay, so based on income. So anything above 6 lakhs. Okay, 10 lakhs of income, and credit score above 700, categorize them as a high income, high credit score customers. So what the bank will do, they will take all the phone numbers of these 10,000 customers, they'll give it to the customer care, and they'll ask them to call and offer the personal loan. Here the bank doesn't know anything about your personal life. Okay, so here they are not predicting whether you can pay the personal loan or not. Okay, whether you can pay the personal loan or not, but they are trying to offer a product just by believing that you are falling into the high income, high credit score category, so that your nature of repayment will be good. So you are a potential good customer, those who are falling into this. So just like in your intermediate classes, when you are preparing for competitive exams, IIT, MCET, so the institute will try to divide you into multiple batches, fast track batch, super fast track batch, advanced batch, okay? So like that. So these batches are divided based on the capability of the students, how they are scoring in the mock test, how they are scoring in the weekly test. So based on that, based on the characters, okay? So are they dividing you based on your name, based on your alphabet, based on your, in any alphabetical order, or based on your roll number? No. So they are purely going by the numbers, your performance numbers. Okay, your performance numbers, they are segregating this into fast track batch, super fast track batch, normal batch, and slow batch. Where for slow batch, they will be putting more and more intensive learning, and for fast track batch, they will be going in a very aggressive mode. Okay, so that nothing but the cluster of students. Clusters are nothing but groups. Okay, so clusters are nothing but, here they are not predicting how much this student will score in IIT, how much this student will score in MCET. They are not trying to predict any number. If they are predicting something based on your weekly test, based on your mock test results, if they try to predict your final exam score, then that is a supervised problem, supervised learning technique. Because looking at your historical performance, they are trying to predict the future value, future outcome. Okay, in future, in final exam, how much you can score. Okay, so this is one thing. Okay, here I am not trying to predict anything. How much you will score in mathematics, how much you will score in physics, chemistry, what is your overall rank. I'm not predicting about anything. I am just creating groups based on the properties that I observed. So that is called unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning, the main problem is clustering. Clustering. The main problem that you will come across in the industry is clustering. Clustering is nothing but creating groups of data points which have similar characters, similar properties. All good scoring students will go into super fast track batch. All decently scoring people will go into fast track batch. People who are performing on an average level, they will be staying in the normal batch. People who are they are not performing very well, they will be going into a slow batch. Okay, so that means only based on the characteristics, the institute is dividing the people into separate groups. These groups are nothing but clusters, and the activity that you are doing is clustering of data points, clustering of students. So that is nothing but an unsupervised technique. Hope that is clear. Okay, so we will discuss. So this is, I tried to discuss it in a plain English and very in layman terms. When we go into the course, okay, so there we will talk in more technical terms with more examples. Okay, so now coming back to this thing. Okay, so these three boxes, okay, so they fall into our curriculum. Okay, now coming to storytelling and communication and subject matter expertise. These are behavioral part of a good data scientist. So a data scientist his skill set should be a combination of technical skills plus non-technical skills. Non-technical skills are nothing but how good team player you are. Okay. And how are you managing the team? How are you coping with the company? How good you are in helping others? All these behavioral, and how are you interacting with the clients? How are you impressing the clients? So these are the non-technical skills. Okay, so these non-technical skills, they will come automatically to you when you start working from your first project. Real-time experience helps to build the storytelling and communication and subject matter expertise. Okay, so what we are going to be, okay, even before joining the job, first you have to be technically ready. Okay, first you have to be technically ready, where these three things will be required for you. Okay, so where these three things will be required for you. Okay, fine. Now coming to the another thing. Big data. Now, what is this big data? Why does a data scientist, we need to talk about big data. Okay. So may not be at the beginning. So in future, okay. So in future, when you get more than 7 to 10 years of experience, when you go from a developer level to an architect level, so there you might need to learn the concepts of big data. Okay, so because there are two types of designations: data scientist, data engineer. Data scientist and data engineer, where primarily this person technical skill set will be machine learning, deep learning. Deep learning, somebody asked about what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning. Machine learning is the, you can say, about basic predictive analytics, so basic version of this data science. Okay, it will try to solve some problems, and much more advanced, where you will be talking about neural networks, artificial neural networks, much more complex algorithms, convolution neural networks, recurrent neural networks. Advanced mode of machine learning is what we call it as deep learning. Okay, fine. So data science, machine learning, deep learning, and Python like programming language, this is the common skill set of a data scientist and statistics. For a data engineer, Hadoop, Hive, Spark, these are some basic technologies that he need to know. Or there are offerings from top cloud computing companies also: AWS, Azure, Google Cloud Platform, which is GCP. Okay, so these are the skill sets of a data engineer. These are the skill sets. So don't get confused about the designation data engineer and data scientist, because they are differentiated based on the skill set and requirement. Okay, so skill set and requirement. No, we don't see here. Our course is to target this one. Okay, our course is targeted on the data scientist skill set. Data scientist skill set. We have separate offerings for data engineering, where we are running a course on AWS. We are running a course on AWS. Okay. So when you reach this 10 plus years of experience, okay, primarily 10 to 15 years of experience, where you will be at an architect level. So where you will be bringing the project, where you will be designing the projects, where you will be building the teams, recruiting the people. So more of you are like a driving the project. So more than a developer, you are much higher level. So, okay. So you should be aware of the big data part also. So just to make sure that you are, so this may be your next 4-5 years of target. In next 4-5 years, in the next few months, first you have to cover these three tiles: this statistics, AI, programming, and data visualization. In next 3 to 6 months, if you are starting today, okay, if you are starting your journey today, in next 3 to 6 months, your journey, your main goal is to target these three, okay, and get into a job. And job will teach you storytelling and communication, subject matter expertise. Okay, so that means out of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tiles, 6 important skill set of a data scientist. Okay, maybe in first six months you will be covering 3. In next 1-2 years, you will be covering the other 2. So this is a time taking process. I hope you understand the reality behind this. Okay, so nobody will become a data scientist in a week, in a 2 weeks. Okay, you might have seen the ads like become a data scientist in three days, in one day webinar, okay, 2-day workshop, okay, just by looking into a 10 hours of YouTube video. They only give you the basics of these three tiles. That's it. It will take at least a good rigorous 3 to 6 months of continuous effort to get good knowledge in these three technical concepts. Okay, three technical concepts and jobs. And we at Enneomatics, we also support the people who performs well in our assignments, quiz, everything. We promote them for the placements. We promote them from the placements, and approximately some 20 to 30 students are already placed in from the last previous batches. Okay, so that is very, very good thing. Okay, so there are people who joined with 21 lakhs package also. Okay, in last month or last before month. Okay, so that is how the demand is. But just because the demand is there, don't rush yourself. don't rush yourself. Don't try to imagine or don't believe that if somebody says that you can get a certificate and you can become a data scientist within 1 month or 1.5 months. That is practically impossible because your mind needs some time to adjust to this new technology. Okay. Fine. And then big data, as I said, it is a separate track and it is not required at this point of time, but for a data science architect level, big data is also required. Okay. So this big data, maybe after 4-5 years of your journey into the data science, suppose say if you become a data scientist by end of 2020, maybe in 2025, you can start. Meanwhile, slowly you can start learning, reading articles, some other books, getting some basic high level knowledge. Slowly you can increase your big data knowledge also. Okay, increase your big data knowledge also. So this is your target. You can keep this target into three things. What is my 6 months target? Okay, so what is my target in 6 months? What is my target in 1 year? What is my target in 2 years? What is my target in 5 years? That's it. By this time, you will be a well-established data scientist in the market. Okay. And you will be like pretty much safe for next 10, 15 years. For next 10, 15 years, you will have that job security. You will have that job security. So that is why, since a data scientist skill set involves all these things, that is why we call it as a interdisciplinary field. It is not like you read this textbook and you become a data scientist. If there is one single textbook like that, then nobody will join any course. Just they'll go by the textbook, read it, done. That's it. Okay. So it takes this amount of effort. Okay. So don't get intimidated by this 5 years number. Okay. Start with 1 month, 2 months, 6 months. You will be in a very good stage. Believe me, after 6 months of continuous effort, once you enroll to a good professional course with a proper curriculum, by the end of 6 months, your friend will find the difference in you. And then he will be interested in becoming like you. Okay. So definitely review yourself for every 6 months. What is my knowledge? What is my knowledge on data science in 2020 May and 2020 December? I have improved a lot. And after 1 year of getting job, yes, now I am very much confident in storytelling and communication. I'm talking better English, better terminology, better concepts with my colleagues and with my peers. And I got a lot of subject matter expertise. Okay, so I am subject matter expertise, having more and more confidence in the area that you are working. Okay, so once you reach this confidence level, then you can start exploring into the other technologies related to the data scientist skill set. The first skill set that is related to data science is the big data skill set. So then you can slowly start learning about the, then you can enroll. By this point of time, you might be earning well, you will be in a good, comfortable position, then you can start. How much opportunity after this pandemic? Okay, so I can tell you, see, if you Google, okay, still Walmart Bangalore, see, Walmart Bangalore is hiring 1600 people and Walmart is opening a new office in Chennai with 800 capacity. There is no pandemic effect on this. Offices are closed. Okay, that is the only reason for the slowdown in the hiring. But that doesn't mean that the hiring is completely stopped. Okay, so there are companies who are doing completely online interviews, online evaluation, and they are rolling out the offers. Okay, so there is, believe me, if you master these things for in next 2 to 5 years, including big data. Okay, so big data, you can start thinking about big data after 2 years of from today. So where you are already comfortable with statistics, AI, Python, data visualization. Once you are already comfortable with this one, then you jump on to big data. Don't think about big data right away. Okay, so then you can start thinking about that. So when you are done with these things, you are almost recession proof. You are recession proof. These type of companies, they will see. You might have heard about situations where companies are removing the people. Companies are removing the people. Let me tell you very frankly. companies are removing people who are into process side, process oriented. What is process oriented? So you will receive an invoice, look at this invoice, type all these details into an Excel sheet, and you process this Excel sheet, create a report. These type of activities, I mean, may not be as simple as this what I said, but roughly imagine these type of people, these types of jobs are at complete risk. They are at complete risk. Okay, so going forward in next few years, these processes will get automated. These processes will get automated. So reading a PDF document, okay, which is NLP, which is nothing but OCR text reading. Already you might have seen some Android apps where if you just upload an image, it will get the text out of that image. That's it. Okay, so OCR plus some classification models. Okay, using by combination of multiple machine learning techniques, the data from the PDF image is translated into an Excel sheet, and that Excel sheet, from based on that Excel sheet, a report will be created. Okay, so and people managers. Okay, so people managers. Who is a people manager? So suppose, let me pick somebody's name. Manish. Okay, so Manish is my manager. So okay, it's fine. Manish is my client. Okay, say Manish is my client. Okay, and I am a developer, and there is a person in between who talks with me, and then he translates that to Manish, and he talks with Manish, and he will get the inputs, and then he'll just distribute. So nothing but what he is doing here, he is just communicating. He is just a bridge between me and Manish. So these type of jobs are also in trouble. Nowadays, startups culture is more in India. So where a developer is expected to perform the business analyst role, developer role, and QA role. Okay, so startups expect they will hire one person. Okay, one person maybe from IIT or so they'll pay some 25 lakhs package, big package. Okay, and they will expect that guy to perform all the roles. That is how the trend of the market is. Okay, so that means, so they don't want process people, people managers, etc., etc. There are some other jobs also. So they want more of a technical guys who are primarily into the cutting edge technologies, latest 2020 technologies, not the older technologies. So that is the reason, even if you see, okay, managers with 10 plus years experience are also enrolling into these courses. They are also enrolling into the courses so that they can safeguard their career for next 10 years. In next 10 years, they will get retired, or they'll get into some other thing, etc., etc. That is another thing. So even 10 plus years managers are also getting enrolled into these courses. Okay, so just to safeguard their career. Okay, so that is the reason this is completely recession proof. So the only thing that your target need to be, even if you join into a small company initially, no problem. Okay, so keep a target in your mind. Try to target a big company like Amazon, Google. Okay, maybe at least after 4 or 5 years. At least after 4 or 5 years of continuous effort. That should be your goal. So there are many companies, they don't remove employees in a pandemic situation or a recession period. Try to make a list of some 10 companies. Okay, so suppose say you can ask, sir, after the course I got a very small job in a small company and they are paying only 15k. That is okay, very good. Compared to your friends who are still searching for a job, you are into a company, you are getting some pay, you are getting a genuine experience, you are getting real-time knowledge. That real-time knowledge, so you can get salary from anywhere, but real-time knowledge, you cannot buy it anywhere. No, there is no course which will give you real-time knowledge. Okay, so that is much more important thing. Okay, so don't. Can you go on mute, please? Okay, so that's why try to complete a professional course, get transform yourself into a data scientist, start working into that area and target some good companies and jump into try to move into those companies in next 2 to 5 years. So that should be your decent target. Then that's it. You are then pandemic proof and recession proof. Okay, so I hope I am clear on this. Okay, so now let me talk about, now we spoke about data science and the basic terminology of the data science and other few doubts that are people asked. Okay, so now the main thing is why data science has become popular. Okay, so somebody told me that Python is existing from 1980s approximately, right? Why it got boom in the recent years. Okay, so why Python community started working rigorously on the data science libraries? See, long back there are no data science libraries available. Even though they are available, their usage is very less. Nobody was bothering about that. Why suddenly there is a boost? Let me tell you one thing. The entire reason of the fame of data science came because of the big data. Because of the big data. Big data is, previously we talk about big data technologies, right? So which is Hadoop, Hive, all those. These are technologies. But what actually big data is? Big data is something which you cannot hold the data in your traditional systems. Like an Excel sheet. Can somebody tell me how many rows you can save in one Excel sheet? Around 100K. As a beginner, in which position I will work as a vast section of analyst, visualization, ML researcher. So Warlock, Demon. Okay. So for this question, these are the designations, different. They are just different names to the same type of job work. Okay. So now you will become an analyst. You will become a visualization specialist. You will become an ML, not researcher. Researcher is a complete terminology into the much more educational mode. So once you complete this course, you can target the designations like data analyst, data scientist, consultant in data science or machine learning, or ML engineer. Okay, so data science engineer. Okay, so don't go by the fancy designations. Okay, when you see a job description in a LinkedIn or a Naukri or some other website, try to read what is expected, what is the technology stack that is expected. Okay, so this course will definitely make yourself to target all these designations for sure. For sure. So don't worry about the designations. Look at the job description. What is the company expecting for you? Okay. What is the company expecting? Whether they are asking Python, whether they are machine learning. So the designation might be different. Okay. Even there are companies, okay, still they call software engineer. Okay. Okay. Software engineer, data and AI. Consultant, data and AI. So nothing but they typically deal with the machine learning technologies, which we are covering in this field. Okay. So yes, thank you. Somebody told that some 100K rows or 10 lakh rows, whatever it may be. So that means our Excel sheet is capable of holding this much amount of data. Clear. And there are some databases like SQL Server, Oracle SQL, MySQL, where you can go up to 10 million rows. Or even 50 million rows also. Say, beyond that, our systems struggle to extract and process the data. Agree with me? Yes, I hope you agree. Okay, because imagine an Excel sheet with 10 lakh rows. Okay, one sheet, 10 lakh rows. Okay, so one sheet, 10 lakh rows. And another sheet with second sheet also 10 lakh rows. Okay. And second sheet also 10 lakh rows. Now the size of this Excel sheet by this now will be more than some 200 MB. And if you open this in a normal 6GB RAM laptop, this laptop will struggle to open this. It will take some time. So normal storage capacity, normal computer capacity, normal Excel file capacity. Okay, so Excel is the software that we are using, and this is the hardware that we are using. Agree with me? Excel is nothing but a software. Microsoft Office software. This RAM, 6GB RAM, i3 processor, all these numbers we are talking about is nothing but the laptop hardware. Okay, so your normal hardware, normal software will struggle to handle the data which go beyond certain extent. Okay, so that we call it as a data long back. Data means whatever that you get in the limited quantities. Okay, limited quantities. Now, what is big data? Look at how many, I'm talking this 0.1, 2, 12, 47, 163 is nothing but zettabytes. Zettabytes of data. What is one zettabyte? One zettabyte, look at this one at the bottom. One zettabyte is nothing but, so are you aware of 1 terabyte hard disk? Are you aware of 1 terabyte hard disk or 500 GB hard disk? Yes, right? I hope somebody of you might be already using 1 terabyte hard disk. Okay. Imagine 1 zettabyte is equal to 1 billion terabytes. Okay. 1 billion terabytes. What is 1 billion? How many zeros in 1 billion? 9 zeros. 9 zeros. 9 zeros in Indian numbering system, how much? In Indian numbering system, 9 zeros means how much? Hundred crore, right?
100 crores.
100 crores, because seven zeros, 1 crore, and still we are left with 2 zeros. So now, 100, and after this, 7 zeros and another 2 zeros, total 9 zeros, 1. So approximately 100 crore 1 terabyte hard disks. 100 crore 1 terabyte hard disks of data, okay, is equal to 1 zettabyte. Imagine how big that is. Okay, even the room that you are sitting in currently, from where you are listening to this demo, even that room will not be sufficient to fit these many hard disks if you place them manually. If you buy 100 crore terabytes of hard disks and if you place them one by one in your room, it will not be sufficient. Okay, so that is the zettabyte. And we had 0.1 zettabytes of data. So that means remove 1 zero. So that means 10 crore terabytes of data is available in 2005. In entire world. Okay, in entire world, how do you calculate? Because all our data is saved across the world in data centers. Okay, if you want to know what is a data center, type in YouTube, Google data center, Facebook data center, like this. So then you will get videos. Data center is nothing but just like in a 5 acres of land, if you are doing agriculture, just like that, in 10 acres of land, 20 acres of land, they will build server farms, not agriculture farms, server farms. Okay, server farms, where these server farms are large godowns having very big data sets, very big hard disks, 24/7, 365 days connected to power and internet. Okay, so where if you create a Gmail, new Gmail ID, how much amount of space you will get? Now, where is this 15 GB you are getting allocated? Where is this 15 GB? In your laptop? Or in your friend's laptop? No, right? In cloud, no problem. Okay, in cloud. Cloud is nothing but, okay, so cloud is nothing but, suppose say Google will have a data center in You can type where is the location of Google data centers. Okay, suppose say in US, so in California they have a data center. This data center will contain say some 20 acres of land. In the 20 acres of land, they will build a big godown type of thing, and they will have huge racks of hard disks, big hard disks, very big hard disks, not like simple 500 GB 1 terabyte which we are using, which much higher capacity. Okay, so they are connected to 24/7, they are connected to power and internet. Okay, so there you will be allocated some 15 GB of space on your email ID. So that means you are connected to internet. Somewhere there is a big hard disk that is connected to internet. So from your laptop, if you open your Gmail using internet, that is connecting to this particular hard disk, big hard disk. So there is a big hard disk, okay, and it is divided into small 15 GB chunks, and this 15 GB is allocated to you, and using internet you will be connecting to that space which is stored somewhere. Okay, so you are accessing your data. Okay, you uploaded some photos to your Google Drive which got saved into this 15 GB, and you can access these 15 your photos from Delhi, from Hyderabad, from Mumbai, anywhere you can access these photos as long as you have their app, application and internet. Agree? So that means you are saving your data on the cloud because you are accessing it through the internet. There is an invisible link between your mobile phone and your data storage, and you are connecting over internet. So that is what cloud storage. Yes, cloud storage, correct, you are absolutely right. Okay, so you are okay, fine. So like that back in 2005 we have only very limited amount of data. Okay, and now 2010 it increased to 2 zettabytes, 2015 it increased to 12 zettabytes, 2020 47 zettabytes is what, and look at in 2025 163 zettabytes of data is going to be saved on the data centers of different companies across the world. And how this data is getting increased? Can anybody tell me how this data is getting increased? Someone can unmute and talk if required.
Using social media apps.
See, now back in 2010, how many Indians have Facebook accounts? Okay. And 2015, how many have Facebook accounts? And 2020 and 2025, a simple example. So when you have a Facebook account, you will be up. Can you go on mute, please? Somebody's mobile phone is ringing. Okay, so just take the Facebook example alone. Okay, so and even somebody if having Facebook, okay, how frequently they are using in 2010? How frequently they are uploading videos? How frequently they are uploading the images? Okay, compared to 2020. Okay, and how easy or how difficult it is to upload a photo or video in 2010? And how easy it is to upload a photo or a video in today's time? Okay, so that means internet cheaper, mobile phones, smartphones cheaper. Okay, data storage cheaper. Because do you remember what is the cost of your first pen drive and size of that pen drive? Okay, initially you may have the 2 GB or 1 GB pen drive which will be approximately 300 rupees or 400 rupees. Now for the same cost you will get at least 16 GB pen drive. So that means the storage devices got much cheaper, data storage. Okay, and internet got cheaper. Just before Jio, imagine we used to pay approximately 250 rupees for 1 GB of data. And now if you recharge for 555, even the highest Jio plan, you will get 3 months validity and daily some 1.5 GB of data. look at how internet got cheaper and mobile phones. So back those days, you have only Samsung, Nokia, and Apple. Okay, some major companies ruling the industry. Now you have how many mobile phones, mobile phone brands now you have? There are n number of mobiles. You have OnePlus, and you have Xiaomi, and you have Lenovo, Oppo, n number of Vivo. Okay, so there are n number of mobile phones at much cheaper rates. So your SIM cards are getting cheaper, your plans are getting cheaper, your mobiles are getting cheaper, your data storage. So see, initially we used to have SIM cards, sorry, not SIM cards, chips, okay, external memory cards. Now these phones are coming with inbuilt memory of 64 GB, 128 GB. So your data storage, so everything got cheaper. Internet is become very fast. So those days where you use 2G data, where you will struggle to see a YouTube video, very, very difficult. So nowadays you can seamlessly see a full movie without any interruption. Okay, so internet speed is increased a lot. So all these factors made more and more data generated. Every photo that you share, every video that you upload, every comment that you make, every tweet that you make, every YouTube video that you upload, everything is a data point. Everything is going and getting saved into respective company's data center. Okay, respective company's data center. Okay, respective company's data center. Okay, fine. So okay, so now that is the reason by 2025, okay, NASSCOM estimated India's data science market will be $16 billion. $16 billion, it is a huge demand. There will be a huge demand for data analysts, data scientists, and data engineers. Still, there are many companies who haven't started their journey into data science. There are many companies who just started hiring data science teams. Okay, so this number will only grow. It will not fall. Because as we move from 2025 to 2030, this bar will be even higher. As there is more data, there is more data to analyze. Who can analyze the data? Data scientist, data analyst. So that means companies' demand will only increase. It will not decrease. So that is the reason big data is going beyond the normal databases, and that's why companies are getting the products from AWS, Microsoft Azure. Okay, these systems. Okay, so these systems. And somebody asked about what is the difference between SQL versus NoSQL. SQL versus NoSQL. I'll tell you this in a simple one sentence. SQL is to handle traditional amount of data. Say maximum some 50 million rows. 50 million or 100 million rows. But after this, SQL will struggle. So NoSQL is nothing but the... NoSQL is nothing but designed to handle big data. Data that is much bigger than the traditional databases. Data that is much bigger than the traditional databases. Okay, fine. So that is how data science became very popular, because of this huge amount of data generation. Okay, fine. So I'll show you a small use case here. Okay, I'll show you a small use case. After this, we will jump onto our final part of our demo. So the best use case is e-commerce. Let me show you another slide. E-commerce search engine. So everybody might have known they use Amazon, Flipkart, Big Basket, Myntra. Okay, at least once a day they will open these apps or these websites, correct? Now, how does this actually work? How does these apps actually work? Okay, so see here. So what you will be doing, you are the user. What is the key difference between the data scientist and analyst? I'll tell you. Okay, data scientist and analyst. Okay, so you are the user. You will search for something. Suppose say Dell Inspiron laptop. Dell Inspiron laptop, and then say you logged into Amazon. You logged into Amazon, and in the text bar, you did you searched for this one, and some processing will happen, and you will get the results. Okay, and you will choose one laptop, and you will buy. Agree? So this is the typical process that we do. You search for a product, you get the product, and you purchase the product. Okay, fine, excellent. Now, what happens? So we are interested in this part. We are interested in this part. When you hit enter after searching, after entering the text, and before getting the results, how much time do we have between entering the result and entering the input and getting the result? Fraction of seconds. These fraction of seconds, in these fraction of seconds, okay, so what will happen? Okay, multiple ML or DL, machine learning or deep learning programs will get executed. Multiple ML or DL programs will get executed in between this fraction of seconds to give the best results for you. Okay. So those who said that a fraction of seconds, thank you for using that particular word, because how can companies run multiple ML and DL programs in just some fraction of seconds, 0.001 seconds? But because they are running on top of big data technologies. Data science cannot exist without big data. And without data science, getting big data technologies is also waste. So these are like two sides of a coin which work hand in hand. If you use normal programs, normal Excel sheets, normal SQL databases, these will not perform this quick. So that's why companies like Amazon, Flipkart, all these invest in data engineers and data scientists. Those who know the backend technology, those who know the machine learning and deep learning technologies. Now clear? So these two teams should work together. Both the data engineering team, data scientist team. Okay, so they both need to work together in order to produce a good working Amazon website. Okay, so good working Amazon website. So now we will see. So you searched for a laptop and you got these results. And how you got these results? This is a fundamental architecture diagram between the search. Fundamental architecture diagram behind the search. So you went to a website and you started searching. Okay, so here, all that, remember two things, observe the difference carefully. Whatever the results that you are seeing here, these are close or relevant results. Okay, so with high accuracy, there is nothing called 100% accuracy in machine learning or deep learning or data science. Okay, so we always try to increase our high accuracy. Okay, 100% is very difficult because there will be some noise, because 100% automation is not possible. 100% automation is not possible. Imagine, even without 100% automation, there is such a huge demand for data scientists. Sorry, okay, so even without that, there is a huge demand for data scientists. Okay. Now, suppose if I go and search HP Spectre laptop, then this keyword, this is plain English sentence, right? Okay. So this will go and hit a underlying database. So here, there are n number of databases, but Apache Solr is a one text-based data retrieval system. Okay, so this will be there, and this will contain all the products that are available in Amazon. Everybody, you can also register as a seller in Amazon, and you can put your products there. So your products will go into this product catalog, and this catalog will be connected to a Solar Apache Solar engine. So the job of this Apache Solar engine is to not get all the HP Spectre laptops. It is not the job. Its job is not to get exactly the HP Spectre laptops. It will not give you the exact output, but it will give you all possible outputs. Suppose if somebody has listed HP Spectre laptop bag, that bag also will come. If somebody given HP Spectre keyboard and wireless keyboard and mouse for HP Spectre laptop, those objects will also come. HP Spectre laptop screen guard, that also will come. HP Spectre, suppose if you are listing some laptop chargers, and at the time of entering the product name, what you entered as HP Spectre laptop charger, that will also come. So the job of the Solar engine is to get all the closest proximity results, it will throw you as the output. Okay. Output. Now what next will happen? Suppose say here you got some 5000 records when I search for HP Spectre. Okay, I got 5000 records when I searched for HP Spectre. Now this data need to be cleaned using a Python file. Okay, so all the names, everything will be cleaned properly. Okay, remove the punctuations, remove the special characters. Okay, so everything. Okay, so first what it will do, there will be a classification model which will predict brand. This is a predicting based on, so predicting so previously we would have used some historical data to train a model. Okay, so this might be like too technical at this point of time, but please bear with me. Okay, so this is a supervised learning, because looking at the historical data for a new search, it will identify which brand the user is searching. Here the brand is HP. HP will be identified. Okay, out of this 5000 rows, if for every row, for every product, it will identify the brand. So then it identified 500 records have some other brand and it is not the HP brand, so it will filter out. So it will get 4500 records here. Now category. Okay, so for each record it will find the category. Okay, so category, this belongs to laptop bag, belongs to accessories category. Laptop screen guard also belongs to accessories. Okay, so all the accessories will be dropped out, only laptops will be kept. Suppose say here 1500 records are dropped. Now say here you have only 3000 records at this stage. Now check the futures. So now you entered HP Spectre i7 laptop. Okay, so if there is additional future, I'll show you in Flipkart website. By adding additional futures, your number of images in the display will increase or decrease. Okay, I will show you that real time example. Okay, now if you don't give anything, maybe you will see these 3000 records in some 10 pages or 20 pages. Then too many results, then you are annoyed. Okay, you added one more keyword, i7 laptop. Okay, looking at the i7 processor, it would have dropped, it would have dropped, it would have dropped another 1500 records. Okay, so where the processor configuration is not matching, and now at the time of image filtering, you are left only with 1500 records. Okay, so even if by mistake, because perfect filtering is not possible, even by mistake, there are some laptop bags, chargers, keyboards are still there in this 1500, then image filtering will happen. Image filtering is nothing but deep learning technique, and the algorithm is based on computer vision field. This is the field and this is the technique. Okay, so now a laptop image will never match with a laptop bag image, laptop keyboard image, laptop mouse image. Okay, so now it will reduce another 1000 records here, and you will be left with 500 records. And in these 500 records, there are some fake products. So suppose say some sellers, just to lure the customers, they put HP Spectre laptop for 20,000, which is absolutely fake, because approximate price of HP Spectre laptop is approximately 1 lakh. okay, which is very far away. Okay, so which is very far away. So based on the price, it will detect some outliers and it will remove some 250 laptops. Okay, say at least 450 laptops. Okay, now finally, those most best filtered records, 50 records will be shown to you. 50 records will be shown to you finally. These many steps, I can say these are the least number of steps that I am explaining. If you go and check the architecture of Amazon and Flipkart, they might be implementing even more number of filters, even high level, detecting the fraud, detecting the fraud sellers, detecting the fraud products, detecting the fake products. Okay, so there are an even more number of filters available, just like filtering the water in a water purifier. In water purifier, your water will be passed to different stages, and in each stage the bacteria will be removed, and you will be getting the purest possible water. they say purest. Okay, so does that mean that you are drinking 100% purified water? No, approximately 99% of purified water. They cannot guarantee 100%. Okay, so but that 1% of impurity may not harm you. That is not problem. That is not at all a problem. Okay, so these things happen in those 0.5 seconds, in those fraction of seconds, in the background. How come these many filters are running or checking within that small amount of time? Because they are using big data systems. They are using cloud computing in the background. Okay, but as a data scientist, you may not be that much bothered about the systems, but as long as what you are bothered, give me the data, I'll write a brand identification problem, code in Python. Give me some data, I will write a category classification program in Python. Okay, give me a data, I'll write image filtering, image classification program in Python. So this is your job. So where the data is stored may not be immediate, it may not be a bother, may not be a concerning point for you. So clear, this is what happens in the background whenever you do a search I entered. I hope everybody is aware of the DSLR cameras and the lenses, right? So Canon EF 50mm. Canon EF 50mm. See, technically this is not the correct title. Very vague title, because a lens will have a complete good title. Okay, complete good title. Look at the number of results. Okay, look at the number of results. I got 21 results when I searched for Canon EF 50mm. Okay, so let me be a bit more technical. So then what I did, then I changed my text. Canon 1.8 STM. Then I got only two results. Because look at this, STM keyword is there. So that means the distance, the closeness between the text and the title. Okay, here input is the, what is the input? Input is the text entered by the user, and it will be compared how relevant or how closely it is matching with the title of the product. All those relevant products will be listed out. Okay, fine. Here also I got some different result. Now here, see, in this I gave Canon EF 50mm STM lens. Now see, look at this one. EF 50mm. I got one more extra output. Okay, so fine. Now what I did, so forget about all these things. Let me put a clean, technical, complete title. Canon EF 50mm F1.8 STM lens. See, now I got more relevant 7 results. For every search, even if you remove one small keyword, the number of results are changing. So that means there is nothing like 100% exact result. There is only relevant result. There is no 100% purified water. There is only the maximum purified water. All these ad agencies, they will show the ads. Use Lysol it will remove 99.99 germs. They are taking the safety of 0.1. They are not claiming 100%. Because if they claim 100%, you can go and buy Lysol and wipe your floor and put some microscope. Still some bacteria will be visible. Is it causing any day-to-day harm for us? No, right? So maximum bacteria is already removed. So we are in a maximum safety position. This is also the same thing. It is not the exact result. Okay, if you want to see, only this first lens is the exact result. Canon EF50mm F1.8 STM lens. And if you observe, this lens is there in every page. See, here also it is there. Here also it is there. And here also it is there. Because that is the closest match. That is the closest match. Because in text classification, in NLP, okay, so in text classification in NLP, okay, so the distance between this user input text to the title will be calculated. And these two will always be very close. Because on a layman terms, okay, no technical stuff, simple stuff. Okay, so Canon matching, EF matching, 50 matching, MM matching. Perfect match. Is there any other title like that? So that is why they are not in the first position. Even this ordering of these products is also based on the closest match. Okay, the NLP algorithms, it will give you, okay, so this first product 90% match. This is 85% match, 70% match, 60% match. Okay. 53% match. Okay, 49% match, 48% match. Based on this matching score, these will be ordered in the descending order. Even the order of the items also will be taken care of these companies. Okay, so there are n number of things that will happen in the background. It is not as simple as what we think, what we discuss. So this is such a complex procedure behind these things. So companies are trying to get better and better in this process. Even you don't believe me, when I first experimented this thing 3-4 months back, I got much vague results. I got laptop lens cover, lens cap, and a laptop bag also. So that means Flipkart is not doing the filtering correctly. But now see, I don't see them because they have refined their algorithm in the background. They're continuously working. 3-4 months back, I got some other products also. I got lens in the first row, but in the second row, I got other products also. But now see, my second row is much cleaner now. So because Flipkart improved their algorithms. That is why. It is not like, so, okay, sir, you are telling that data scientist has a very good future. So after writing one algorithm, what is my future? There is no perfect 100% algorithm. As the data increases, you need to rework on the algorithm. You need to rework again. Fine tune it. That's it. So that will be there. The dependency for the companies on the data scientists like you and me will be there forever. At least for next 10, 15 years. Clear? So these are the things that happens in the background. Whatever the use case that we have seen in the PowerPoint presentation is what I have shown you now. Okay, so clear? Now here, these are the combination of multiple. This is a ML technique, deep learning technique, and this may be a ML or deep learning technique. So combination of ML and DL algorithms, not one single algorithm. It is not one single algorithm. There is no one single magic algorithm that will work for Amazon for all the requirements. For every requirement, there will be algorithm. So Amazon here is having huge amounts of data. That's why I think you are aware of Amazon invested a lot in Hyderabad and they created their biggest development center outside US. So imagine, without a benefit of next 20-25 years, will the world richest person will invest that much amount of money outside US? Basic logic. See, I'm talking about the concept of job security. Do you think how, see, you are spending some 1 lakh or 1.5 lakh or something today learning a course. So and you and we are thinking and we are thinking about our job security, which is absolutely right. Okay, so which is absolutely right. So because we need to the we need that return on investment, ROI. That is your right. You have to know what will be the return of investment. Is my 1 lakh safe? Whatever that I am investing 1 lakh, you are not spending. Always remember, I always tell the tell students that you are not spending. Spending is you go and spend 1,000 rupees. Go to a movie and come back, that's it, gone. But you are investing. Investing is nothing but a investment will have good returns in the future. A investment. So put a FD of 5 lakhs. After 1 year, you will get 5.5 lakhs. Okay. So just like FD. So that means you just plant a seed today, it will go into a, it will grow into a tree after go into a good tree after 2-3 years, then it will start giving the fruits and shade. Will the seed grow into a tree overnight? Will your FD become 5.5 lakh 5 lakhs to 5.5 lakhs overnight? No. So there is some amount of time that you have to give for everything to mature. Okay, you will get the maturity. Today, at this point of time, the many of these terminologies might be like, oh, what he is talking. So he is talking too much of technical stuff. That's fine. Okay. Even on the day one, I felt just like you. I am just one of you guys long back sitting and listening to somebody else. So now, if you have that commitment, invest today and you will get good returns in next 2 to 5 years. Patience, commitment and practice is required. As simple as that. Okay, fine. So now let me go back. Okay, let me go back and talk our final topic. So we are little over time. I don't want to hold you guys for a very long time. Okay, so okay, see here. Now, we spoke about the data science importance, everything. Okay, so now the course at Innomatics. Now, how does the course at Innomatics is going to help you? I can see Andrew NG ML course. I didn't get you. Manish?
Sir, that's basically Andrew NG machine learning course
yes.
Symbol, sir.
Oh yeah, thank you. Yes, I got it from Google. Yeah. Yes, yes. So I got this when I typed for a ML scholar image. Okay, ML scholar image. I got this image. Yes. So Andrew NG, he is one of the first person to launch a famous professional course. I don't remember anybody become that famous before him, but I remember he is the first person who became very famous. Okay, very famous. Okay, fine. Now what I'm trying to say here, okay, at Innomatics, how are we going to help you to help you? Mathematics topics. Okay, fine. Okay, so fine. Now, as part of this, I'll try to explain. Okay, who asked that doubt? Warlock. Okay, fine. So now at Innomatics, okay, at Innomatics, how we are capable of helping you to reach your goal. Okay, so how capable we are first. Okay, so we have almost, we trained almost 1500 plus students. Okay, in past year with more than 35 plus specialist data scientist trainers and 70 plus all other trainers, because we also have programs on digital marketing, AWS, DevOps, etc. Okay, so all together we have, and we have recognized as the best ML AI institute in Hyderabad by Times Group. So Times Group has conducted a survey and we stood top, and we proudly received the award for this. So that is our recent achievement, so which even I am proud of. Okay, so and also because of this achievement, okay, so we are also just like a startup. Okay, Innomatics is also a startup a couple of years back. So but we struggled hard. We tried to bring more quality than other institutes. Okay, so we tried to compete with ourselves. So how can we better our curriculum? How can we better from the last batch? How can we better how can we design a good curriculum? How can we design a curriculum to meet the industry need? So we struggled a lot from last 2 years. That resulted in a recognition from the Times Group Award, and because of which our visibility now increased a lot. Now because of which now we partnered with IBM. IBM recognized as a certified partner, and they are now working with us to launch few IBM certified courses. IBM certified courses. Okay, so now from last 1.5 years, our visibility in this area is cross the city, cross the state, and it is going pan India. And it is going pan India because the Times Group and IBM are not limited to one city. So can somebody go on mute, please? Okay, so with this amount of vast experience in this particular field, okay, so our program will help you in upskilling yourself. And let me be very frank and clear, not just whatever that I'm talking is, I don't want to market the course from the institute side, but let me be very frank with you. Okay, so it is you that you are going to decide to invest that amount of money and time in this. So we should always leave the decision to you. Okay, keeping you as the prime. Okay, you as the prime. So how can you upskill yourself? How can you learn a new technology? Three things. If you are working in a company, the company identified that you are a good candidate, and they identified some 10-20 candidates. Okay, like you, they identified some 10-20 candidates. Okay, and they hired a trainer. Okay, so I hope you are aware, right? Companies hire some trainers and they identify some candidates in their company. So all the costs the company will bear, and they will train these 20 people. And if any of you are lucky enough to be like this, get trained by your company on data science technology, very well, excellent. Okay, you are one of the luckiest person. Okay, fine. Now the second thing is signing up to a professional course. That is why we are here. That is why what we are talking about from last 2 hours, signing up a professional course. Okay, I will talk about the importance of this professional course after discussing the third point. You can ask, sir, why should I sign up for a professional course paying some 70k, 80k, 1 lakh? Okay, what is the purpose? Why? Because whatever that you are teaching is available on Google. Then why should I sign? Why should I? Yes, absolutely. No, not required to join a course. As long as you have the basic, okay, so the fair amount of idea how to travel how to gain this knowledge, not required. But major issue with the Google is Google will give you articles. Okay, Google will give you articles. How many articles? Lakhs of articles. The main problem is where to start and where to end. If you keep on, you will open an article, from there you will go to another article, from there you will go to one YouTube video, and that's it. You will revolve around the same topic. You will revolve around the same topic there and then and there itself, and then you will lose the interest. And there is a risk of losing the interest, and then you may stop thinking about this technology completely. Okay, fine. And another issue. You learned some technique, but how to build a project, end to end project, again difficult to find freely online. Okay, so Okay, so end-to-end project, how will you get an end-to-end project? Okay, very difficult. Okay, how to practice using some use cases? How to practice some use cases? Again, end-to-end complete use cases, difficult to get online. And how to refresh your knowledge using assignments and quizzes? You don't get online that easily. Okay, so there is a lot of struggle. Okay, there is a lot of struggle, and in between all these struggles, the main intention of learning data science will disappear within a week or two. That's it. So that means that is the major problem with following Google. Okay, so that is the reason. That is the reason signing up to a professional course will follow a structure which will have some limits, so that you don't spend 1 week, 10 days on a single topic. Okay, so whatever is required, okay, that is crisply delivered to you, crisply delivered to you, and projects, case studies, and hackathons, quiz, assignments, a proper structure of curriculum along with the supporting code, end-to-end code, complete code, things will be provided to you. So making you more focused. Focus is important. Okay, making you more focused. So that is the reason, always when you are not only data science course, anything that you if you want to learn into UX UI design, first try to find out a better course, join that, so that you will know what is required for the outside industry. What is required for the outside industry. Then only learn that. That's it. You are not required to learn. See, somebody asked about mathematics in data science. Okay, some part is linear algebra is required, calculus is required. Okay, so that doesn't mean that you have to go and buy a linear algebra calculus textbook and read it completely. Only some part of this is required for you to gain the knowledge in data science. That some part will be delivered to you. Regression analysis. Okay, regression analysis. Okay, and most of the mathematics topics is nothing but what you have learned in 10th, 11th, and what types of projects are we going to, academic projects, real time projects. So see, we will have case studies built out of the famous data sets that are available in Kaggle. Okay, and also the machine learning libraries. Okay, so those things, and along with you will be having like fake currency note recognition hackathon. Okay, so these kind of some exciting projects also will be offered to you. Okay, and building a chatbot. Okay, so different types of case studies. Okay, you will build from scratch. Okay, so that is, yes, tell me, somebody is asking. Hello, is somebody asking something? Okay, fine. So these structured way will help you to focus more on what is required to learn. Okay, so that is why. So once you learn something from a structured course, yes, resume and LinkedIn. I always talk to students separately, whoever needs this assistance, so to make over their resume and LinkedIn profile, and whatever the projects that you do in the as part of the course in the institute, you can keep them in your LinkedIn resume and also GitHub profile. These are some things that we also provide. We talk to the people separately, those who want assistance. So that's what, not like other institutes where after the course you will be left out. The relationship will continue. Either for your profile making, LinkedIn profile, resume, and also placement support. Okay, so those who perform well on the hackathon, quiz, and assignments, so perform well and be in the top position, and you will be automatically picked up for the placement. Okay, so we struggle hard. You struggle in the course. You put your struggle in the course. We will struggle for you after the course. As simple as that. You struggle in the course time, After the course time, we will struggle for you. Okay, we will bring the placements for you. We will bring the placements for you. That is why our relationship with the students is much more beyond the course. So that is why you don't believe almost 20 plus students, those who joined with other institutes. Okay, so they came and joined with us again, and they are like pretty much happy after completing the course when they compare to the previous course. So, but again, we are not discriminating anybody here. We are not discriminating any other course, because every course, every institute will have their own benefits. Okay, so we always try to add more value to you and your money. Okay, whatever that amount that you are paying is your hard-earned money. So we respect that, and we struggle hard for that to bring more value for you. That is our main motto. Now, how the professional course is going to help? Okay, see here. So first we will start with building blocks. So I'll quickly complete this one. Building blocks where, so forget about R. This is a generic slide. So we'll start with Python, and then stats and probability and data visualization. This is your building blocks module. And then we will jump on to supervised and unsupervised. Okay. So since for few students, those who initially they did not wanted deep learning, NLP, computer vision, they want only supervised. So that's why we have advanced level course and expert level course. Okay, so advanced will have this, and expert will have this, and expert will have this. And later we identified the industry is also requiring for big data, you have AWS separate course, that is okay. So the industry is also demanding a data visualization tool, Yes. Kalpana, yes. Kalpana is one of our co-founders along with Vishwa. Okay, so later we identified, data visualization is also one of the demand from the recruiters. Okay, so then we introduced the top tool in the market, Tableau. Tableau is the leading data visualization tool, okay, which will safeguard your career, Okay, so we included this, and also we included SQL, database querying, as add-ons. Okay, so these are included. No separate money for this. So these are included. We have online course all included. Yes, whatever that we are talking here, all the advanced level course, expert level course is available both online. Okay, since we are in lockdown, and post lockdown, okay, we will open up our institute also. So you will be having options in both the ways. Okay, so you will be getting Tableau and SQL also. Okay. And I remember somebody asked about what is the difference between data scientist and data analyst. I will talk about that now. Okay. And once your course is done, we will help you in placement and profiling. Your resume, GitHub, projects, LinkedIn, we will help you from our side. So this makes that course a comprehensive and a complete one. Comprehensive and complete one. Now somebody asked. Yes.
Sanjeev John.
Hi, Sanjeev.
And before going to the difference part, I was told that there'll be an IBM certification along with the course part. Can you
put some light over it? Okay, fine. So course one, course two, and along with that, you have the option to choose IBM certified courses. I think there are two or three courses. Raghu will assist you on that. Raghu will provide you the curriculum on that. So those who are opted for this one, they will have the separate curriculum designed by IBM people. And yes, these will come with some additional charges. Okay, so Raghu will help you in understanding these charges, because you will be having separate curriculum designed for this one, and evaluation will be done by the IBM people, and you will be getting a certificate also. So because of all these things, okay, so there will be some additional charges incurred. Okay, so this is our courses offered from Innomatics side, and this is in partnership with the IBM.
What does the certificate actually talk about?
The title. Okay, whether you are an IBM certified data scientist course.
Okay.
Okay, IBM certified applied scientist, that will be written on the top of the certificate, whatever the course that you are choosing. Okay, whatever, if you have chosen, suppose IBM data analyst course, I don't want, suppose say Sanjeev said, okay Amresh, I need only IBM data analyst, not data scientist. Okay, fine, you are free to choose that one. I don't know exact the title, what titles are given to that.
I will get in touch with Raghu then.
Yeah, okay, so whatever the title course, whatever the course that you are enrolling, so that will, you will be receiving the IBM certified. Okay, exam certification course, can we see the sample certificate? Maybe, yes, please get in touch with Raghu with those things. Okay. Okay, so yep. Okay, so now what is now? Okay, fine, you are done with all these things and you started job searching. Now what kind of jobs that I can target? Okay, so what kind of jobs? Data analyst. Sorry guys, if I am taking too long, please bear with me, we are almost done. Okay, data scientist and data visualization specialist. Because I have seen this data visualization specialist also in LinkedIn. Okay, so data visualization specialist, if you don't get a job directly data scientist, don't worry, enter into a data related job. See, if this is the data scientist job, if you are not exactly striking here, at least strike somewhere here, which are closely relative. See, sales executive and data analyst. Just by common sense, which job is more closer to data scientist? Data analyst, right? Compared to the sales executive. So if you are missing this target, you should be able to hit at least the nearby targets. So by that way, first of all, you will change the domain into data side. And then within an year or two, you can jump again into data scientist. So data analyst, data visualization specialist is nothing but where they will have the building blocks and these add-ons. Data analyst or data visualization specialist is somebody where they will have the Python skills, all these basic building block skills and add-ons. Okay, so you can prepare a resume for data analyst, you can prepare a resume for data scientist, you can prepare a resume for data visualization specialist and go into the market. Your probability of hitting a job is more now rather than keeping one profile and waiting for 3-4 months. That is what. Okay, so that is what. Okay, so that is the reason, that is the difference. Data scientist, who includes this machine learning or deep learning part also. That's it, that is the major difference. So now that's why we have divided this into proper modules so that you will get a good understanding about how the recruiters are putting the job descriptions, what kind of job roles are coming into the market. Okay, so what types of job roles are you can target. So all those things, again, we will talk in personal. Okay, so all those things we will help you as part of your profile evaluation and marketing. As part of profile evaluation marketing, we will try to see what are the best roles that can be suited for you.
When you call data visualization, the tools like Tableau and Power BI, are they not, when we precisely talk about data visualization, it's not the data, the raw data or the massage data, what we just have represented as per graphs or...
Yes, exactly. In order to massage the data, you need to know the programming languages.
Right.
So you are not a Tableau developer alone. You have the edge than other people in the industry. You know a database query and also you know a programming language. You are more technical guy. Okay. And also you can target business analyst with technical skills. There are companies where business analyst demanding for Python, Tableau and SQL. You can target these jobs also. Okay, so never go by designation. Always spend some time reading the job description. What exactly the company is asking?
Okay,
no problem. We will help you with the profile marketing. Okay, so don't worry on that particular front.
Is it not business analyst more precise to what you call domain?
Maybe I can call it as a technical business analyst.
Okay.
Technical business analyst. Yes. Okay, so on the paper it may be business analyst, but technically you might be working, because if you see my designation, I am a senior consultant too. Okay, senior consultant too. Okay, so where I will be working on both data science projects and also Azure, Microsoft Azure projects. Okay, so companies will put you in different roles, right? So these are only on the paper designations. So don't go by the designations. Your day-to-day activities might involve more technical skills.
So now data analyst, how do you, is it more like an analysis, predictive analysis, or?
Yes, you will be given raw data and you have to use your technical skills and SQL skills to massage the data and build interactive dashboards out of that and present to the clients. When you bring the machine learning flavor to that, then you will be called as suppose you got a data analyst offer. Okay, please do not reject that just because you are waiting for a data scientist job. First, get into this one and keep on showcasing your skills in the current company. If you are getting a job there, that is fine. And then immediately, maybe after 6 months to 1 year, you can start again putting your data scientist. And again, even after 1 year also, you can come back to the institute and come back to us and check with us if there is anything that we can help you.
Right. So, I'm sorry to re-ask this. And what is the core difference between data analysts and data scientists? Analysts find them analyzing some data, which could be source independent. It could be an Excel. It could be text format, whatever.
Yes. Suppose you received a bunch of data in Excel sheet and text files. Right. Okay. So a non-technical data analyst. Okay, what he will do, he will manually open the Excel, manually open the text and manually do all the processing in Excel sheet. But since you know the Python, just write a simple Python script to load the data from Excel, load the data from text.
Right.
That will make your job much easier.
No, I totally agree that. I mean, if at all I have to give a clear difference between analyst and a scientist.
Okay.
So we are saying that when we are using ML or deep machine learning or deep learning part of it, that becomes an data scientist kind of a thing.
Correct.
Who is an analyst as such? And the one who has a basic knowledge of acquiring or consuming the inputs or sources to one common platform, trying to massage it. And close to that, when you're adding a flavor of what do you call machine learning and part of it, that's where you will be called as a scientist.
Yes.
Or just
data, yes. Data acquisition, analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is analyst. So for the data acquisition and analysis, you will be using these building blocks technologies and add-ons technologies.
Okay. Can I put it in this way? The person, I mean, an extended version of a business analyst who is bringing the logic, wherein the further converting into a functional output using a code part of it becomes a scientist, the person who is actually bringing the logic to be implemented.
See, as you said, a data analyst who is bringing the machine learning flavor to the table is called data scientist.
Okay.
So because why data analyst? Because whenever I talk to the people while preparing their resume, while helping their resume, I need to talk to them. What are you doing today? Because many of the people are already doing 90% job of data analyst. So which makes them very close to data scientist. See, a data scientist require data analysis skills. Okay. So without knowing that they are already a good data analyst, they'll be struggling to put what to put in the resume. Once I talk to them, then I'll identify, okay, fine. Already you are doing majority of the data scientist responsibilities, because data analyst responsibilities are already a part of data scientist responsibilities. Agree with that?
Agree. Yeah.
My yes. Agree. So that means majority of your resume inputs are already available with you as part of your day-to-day life activities. So then you will get more confidence. Okay, I'm already 50% into this one. Let's see, what can I do to represent the other 50%?
Sure.
Clear?
No. I got it.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes, tell me.
Sir, I have a simple doubt. Mm-hmm. I know supervised learning, I know unsupervised learning, I know data visualization and analytic thing. During the hiring process, am I the one which says that I need this position, or the hiring team says that you are capable for this position?
It is you. First read the JD and put the application. If you don't apply to the job, there is no matter of talking to the recruiter. Right or not?
Okay. So all the position will be already mentioned in the JD.
Yes. Not positions. What are the required skills?
Okay, skills.
Okay, so the candidate need to have Python skills. The candidate need to show good experience in machine learning and deep learning. Candidate good, it will be an added advantage to the candidate if they have SQL knowledge. Additional advantage if they have Tableau knowledge. So like that, they will clearly mention. They will clearly mention. If not, go ahead and blindly apply. Whenever recruiter calls, initiate a discussion and then talk to the recruiter. So what kind of technologies that you are expecting, what kind of projects that you are dealing, talk again, build a relationship with the recruiter. Even though if you don't clear the interview, talk to the recruiter, ping him in the LinkedIn, send him a connection invite, improve your network.
Okay.
So if not the job, at least your network is increasing, right? So something or other, you are getting so at least it is great that you got a response. So some people, they will try for 1 month, 2 months, they don't even get a call. Okay. But you will be in a much better position if you get a call.
Okay.
Yes.
And one more thing. Is internship important?
Is internship important? So tell me one thing. Are you a fresher? Because for a fresher, internship roles are, yes, good. Yes, for an experience, for an experienced person, internships, see, typically internships are designed for freshers.
Okay.
Where companies take those people and they will directly put you into a real-time environment and you will be working with a team for 6 months. And when the project is over, then your internship will be done. So that is a very, very value-added advantage where you can showcase your skills.
Correct.
Never ever look internship as a small thing. It is a very, very, very decent thing.
Correct.
And as long as you keep on working on internship on weekends, you try applying in Naukri and LinkedIn or any other monster.
I have tried our internship. So I have completed my 2 internships. Sir.
Excellent. Then you have a very good resume. Then excellent. Yes. So, sir,
I have a doubt.
Yeah. 1 second before coming to you, let me formally end this demo. So thank you guys for your patience. Almost it is 2.5 hours. So where initially we started with almost 28 people and half of the people are now, hope the interaction is decent. At least that's what I can expect. So, and you got whatever the inputs that you are expecting and hope this is a good fruitful demo for you. Okay. So thank you for your patience and I'm looking forward to meet you again in the future. So who knows, you will be like coming into my batch. Okay. So again, please do remind me at that point of time. Okay. Okay, fine. Yes. That's it from my side and you can ask your doubts.
Yes, sir.
Sorry to interrupt everyone, that I am Raghuram. Just a small information from my end that, I've been posting the curriculum and a few details regarding us in the chat. I don't hope you have seen it, but let me put that my word. We have shared you the curriculum in the chat. Please do download it. And further details, it's already has taken to the 2.5 hour session, right? Please reach out to our phone numbers. That's our phone numbers in terms of, the batch details or the about the IBM certification. You can reach out to that number. I've already given 9915466 6670. Please, any sorts of queries in other than the technical in terms of.